This is Kurt Heisinger, accounting professor at Sierra College and author of Managerial Accounting. This video describes the impact that income taxes can have on capital budgeting decisions, and more specifically on the cash flows that are associated with capital budgeting decisions. Most firms, first bullet point here, other than nonprofit and government agencies, must pay income taxes. And the firms that pay income taxes have to consider the effect that these taxes have on the cash flows of projected long-term investments. So remember, capital budgeting has to do with long-term investments in things like production facilities for a company that will last for many years. And what we need to do then is to look at the cash flows associated with these proposals, these long-term investment proposals, and determine whether it makes sense to take them on. And this video is focusing on, well, what are the income tax consequences on those cash flows? So we'll talk about that here. Revenues related to cash inflows increase taxable income, and we have to pay taxes on those revenues. So the true cash flow that we receive from those revenues is something less than the actual revenue. We'll talk about how to figure that out. And the same comment goes for expenses. Those are related to cash outflows and reduce our taxable income. So we'll take a look at how income taxes impact cash flows associated with expenses as well. What you see here is a summary of the adjustments that have to be made to these different types of cash flows if we are a company that has income taxes. We'll go through this in order. The first item that you see here relates to investment cash outflows. So, for example, if we are going to be purchasing a piece of equipment for our company, we're going to have to pay for that equipment. That's the cash outflow. There's no adjustment necessary for these types of cash flows. It does not affect our taxable income. And then the second cash flow you see here is working capital cash outflow and potentially inflow. And working capital is defined as current assets minus current liabilities. So it's things like the cash necessary on hand for, let's say, we want to open up a retail store somewhere. It's the cash that we as headquarters have to provide that retail store. It is the cash that we would provide for that retail store to stock inventory. Those are just some examples of working capital cash outflow. And perhaps that retail store will send that cash back to us over the course of several years, and that's the cash inflow associated with that working capital. No adjustment is necessary for these working capital cash flows, so no need to make any adjustments there. The third item you see here is revenue, the revenue cash inflow. And as I stated on the previous slide, the revenue that we receive requires us to pay income taxes on it, and so the true cash that we're going to get from that revenue is something less than the actual revenue we're going to receive from our customers. And therefore, what we do to adjust that revenue to figure out the actual cash flows we're going to receive, the after-tax cash flows that we're going to see, is to take the revenue and multiply it by 1 minus the tax rate. So if our tax rate, let's say, is 40%, we would take 1 minus 0.4, and we would multiply the revenue times, therefore, 0.6, as an example. The same adjustment is needed for our expense cash outflows. We multiply to get the actual cash outflow. We multiply that times 1 minus the tax rate, because there's actually a tax benefit to paying expenses. So the true cash outflow would be something less. And in the previous example, we would use the same tax rate of 40%. We would multiply the expense cash outflow times 1 minus 0.4 or times 0.6 to get the true cash outflow. And then what you see at the bottom here is depreciation expense. And depreciation expense, although it's not a cash outflow, does affect our taxable income. It reduces our taxable income. So to get the actual cash benefit, or what's often called the tax savings or tax shield, we would take the depreciation expense and multiply it by the tax rate. So in the example we've been using, we would multiply it by 0.4 to get the actual tax savings, cash tax savings, from that depreciation expense. So this is a summary of the adjustments that we would have to make to our cash flow before taxes to get the actual cash flow after taxes. And that's the information we need to figure out the net present value and internal rate of return associated with the long-term proposal that we would be looking at. Let's look at an example of a company that is trying to find the net present value that has, and it's a company that has to pay income taxes. I'm going to just briefly look at this slide, all of the details on the next slide. So we'll spend a significant amount of time on the next slide. But here we're looking at a company that is considering a five-year contract to build scientific instruments, let's say, for a large school district. And so we are a company that we're called Scientific Products Inc. that has to pay income taxes. The cash flows and the net present value calculation are all shown on the next slide, so we'll get to that in just a second. And then the footnotes on the next slide, we'll spend some time on that as well, because it describes the impact of income taxes on our net present value calculation. So once again, we are Scientific Products, Inc., and we pay income taxes, so we're going to have to make some adjustments to our cash flows, and then from there, figure out the net present value of this long-term investment proposal. The cash flows that are associated with this long-term investment proposal are shown right here in this chart. And realize that the cash flows you see here are after-tax cash flows. And the footnotes will spell out how we got from before-tax cash flows to after-tax cash flows. Let's start with the two easier items that don't require any adjustments. Let's assume that the purchase price of the production equipment will be $40,000. And to make these scientific instruments, and we're going to need to provide working capital totaling $50,000. So those are both cash outflows, and they do not affect our net income, and therefore we don't have to make any adjustments to either of those cash flows. Next, we're going to take a look at we'll just go about line by line here, the annual after-tax cash receipts. So take a look at footnote B down here, and you'll see that we predict in the first year, and I'm just providing this information here, that in the first year we expect to see cash receipts of $50,000. Well, we need to adjust that to after-tax cash receipts related to revenues, and we do that assuming a rate of 40%, an income tax rate of 40%. I'm giving you all this information right here, that we would need to multiply that cash inflow of $50,000 times 1 minus the tax rate, and that gives us 50,000 times 0.6 gives us $30,000 then in expected after-tax cash receipts, and that's right here in year one. So that's an example of the first year. We would do this for subsequent years as well. We would take the expected cash receipts, and assuming they're from revenues, and multiply those cash receipts times 1 minus the tax rate to get the after-tax cash receipts. The next item relates to our annual depreciation tax savings, and that's this line that you see right here, annual depreciation tax savings. And so there's some information we need to go through. You'll look at the footnote C down here at the bottom, and this spells out what's going on here. We are going to be buying some production equipment, as I mentioned earlier, for $400,000, and the useful life is expected to be 5 years. And so we're going to use a straight line approach. We're going to have depreciation expense, and there's no salvage value, so the depreciation expense will be $80,000. What we need to do, though, is to convert that to our actual tax savings. So we need to take the $80,000 and multiply it by the 40% rate, and that gives us annual tax savings right here of $32,000. And so you'll see that each year for 5 years, right on down the line, all the way to year five. So this gives us an example of how to calculate after-tax cash flows. There's an example here of after-tax cash receipts. I don't think I mentioned it earlier, but after-tax cash receipts would include both the sales revenue and expenses and the net amount of those two. We could have split them out here, but we just show them as one net cash inflow. So this shows how to take before-tax cash receipts and convert them to after-tax cash receipts, and it also shows us how to take depreciation expense and convert that to the cash tax, the cash that results from the tax savings from that depreciation expense. Then the last part of this is simply to figure out the net present value once we have our cash flows from this proposal. So we would simply take those after-tax cash flows, multiply them by the present value factor, and I have a separate video that shows how to find the net present value. So you need to take a look at that to confirm how to perform the rest of this analysis. But we simply take the cash flows and multiply it by the present value factor to figure out the present value. And the present value in this example is a negative $56,146. And recall that the net present value rule is if the net present value is positive, accept the proposal. If the net present value is negative, reject the proposal. So in this instance, we would reject this proposal.